Hi everyone, it's Stephanie with the patient story, and I hope you're doing well wherever you're joining us from. I'm extremely excited to introduce our special guest today, who is a very extremely busy person. And so I'm very grateful you made the time, Dr. Joseph Mikhael, who is the Chief Medical Officer at the International Myeloma Foundation, as well as a professor at the TGen. And so Dr. Mikhael, you know, again, thanks for joining us.
Oh, it's a pleasure to join you, Stephanie, always, and always great opportunity to share some of the amazing things that are happening in myeloma so that all of the patients and their families that are following you can hopefully learn from some of the great things that are happening.
And there are so many in myeloma, which has been extremely exciting, but as you know, difficult to parse out sometimes for people, right? And I'm so glad you mentioned it's not just patients, but their families also we're providing this content for. So let's just get right to it. We know that ASH, this big conference, just happened with these big highlights happening about different studies and emerging therapies and going from triplets to quadruplets in terms of therapies. And so let's start with the screenings. And you mentioned two studies, right? There's iStop in Iceland and Promise. So if we start with iStop, high level, this is in Iceland. It's a project that, is it true? It's the largest screening of any cancer project in the world so far?
That's as far as I know. I mean, it's the numbers are jaw-dropping when we think about it. I mean, there were over 80,000 people in Iceland who consented to participate in the study. And that in of itself actually is one of the most important things we learned, that it is feasible to do a huge screening study. They've already collected over 75,000 samples trying to detect myeloma at its earliest stages. As we know, myeloma has a precondition called MGUS, or monoclonal gammopathy of undetermined significance. And there's a lot still to learn about MGUS. What is the true incidence of it? How should we follow it? Is there a way to detect it earlier? Is there something that puts certain people at risk? Does it mean something even if someone doesn't ultimately develop myeloma? A very small subset of people with MGUS will develop myeloma. So these are some of the questions that only a screening study of that magnitude could answer. And so it's very exciting to start to see. We still don't have anything definitive per se. We're not suggesting that we now go and screen everyone, but we're starting to learn as to who is at higher risk. What does MGUS really mean? And ultimately, we hope to be able to detect it not only sooner, but maybe even know who's really at risk and possibly even prevent it.
And I know we'll talk about that with the PROMISE study too, but can you talk high level about, I know it's early so far, what are the biggest takeaways from the iStop?
Well, I think some of the biggest takeaways are that, as I mentioned, it's feasible to do a big screening study, that when we use our most sophisticated techniques, which includes mass spectrometry, we really do find that this is a common condition. And we know that with the Caucasian background of patients in Iceland, their risk tends not to be as high. And that's why we'll come to the PROMISE study in a minute. But even then, you know, in patients over the age of 40 or 50, we're seeing, you know, around 5% of people that have this. And interestingly, a half of 1% have smoldering myeloma, which is a step between MGUS and true myeloma. So to see that high a percentage, you might think half of 1% is small, but to actually have a diagnosed malignancy of that magnitude, you know, we always think of myeloma as being kind of rare disease. It, you know, accounts for 2% of all tumors, but this is really quite common in its earliest stages. And, you know, although we have screening programs, for example, and trying to detect things early in breast cancer and in colon cancer and in many other areas, we really haven't been doing that much in the hematology world. And so I think iStop is really starting to open the door towards that. We want to do it intelligently and appropriately, but it's definitely taking us down that path.
Dr. Mikhael, you talked about mass spectrometry, which I'd first like for you to explain, what does that?
Yeah, so let me demystify it, because actually, ultimately, I don't think it's going to be that expensive. I think it's going to be cheaper in the long run. So when we look at a disease like myeloma, it's a disease of proteins in the blood. And think of a mass spectrometer as just a really careful machine that can look at every tiny little protein in your blood and be able to quantify it very accurately. If most myeloma patients or their caregivers saw how we measure some of the proteins in their blood, or the M spike, that monoclonal protein, we typically do it on what's called a serum protein electrophoresis, which is just a way we put the blood on a plate and it runs over a period of time. And based on the weight of those different proteins, they kind of separate themselves out. And sometimes it's like the hills here in Scottsdale, you know, they run into each other and it's hard to know how big is this one protein versus the other. Mass spectrometry provides it very precisely. So it can detect low-level proteins, which is really benefit number one, that it has that earlier detection. It measures them very accurately. It can also discriminate between different proteins. Sometimes now we use drugs in patients that themselves have a protein component, things like monoclonal antibodies, and they show up on a serum protein electrophoresis, and it can kind of confuse us, like how much is the drug and how much is actually the disease, and the mass spectrometer is able to distinguish that. And sometimes, unfortunately, in myeloma, proteins can change over time. And so mass spectrometry can know exactly which was the one that they had before and which is the one that they have now. So it's really a fancy way of looking very careful at these proteins. And yes, the technology and the machine itself may be initially relatively expensive, but in the long run, as it may be able to replace serum protein electrophoresis, it'll be a lot cheaper because serum protein electrophoresis takes a lot of time in the lab, and a lot of human effort. And with a mass spectrometer, we might be able to get people's results literally within minutes. Right now, a lot of myeloma patients end up coming in a week before their visit or several days before their visit to get tested so that we can wait for all these results to cook in the lab. Here, we can do a much quicker turnaround.
Could you ballpark how many different centers or specialists are using mass spectrometry now versus the SPEP or
the SPEP. So I mean, it's not been adopted universally yet. In fact, it's not formally, you know, gone through the full FDA approval to be used yet. That we anticipate, though, that it may be available as early as 2023, in the first quarter of 2023, so in a little over a year from now. There are some centers that are using it as we're validating the tool more and more at Mayo Clinic and other places. So it's not yet ready for prime time. It's being used in some of these clinical trials, like it was used in iStop. It's being used in the PROMISE study that I know we're going to chat about. But it really is, I think, going to be mainline in a little over a year from now.
Okay, that's good to know. Thank you for that. I had read something about, you know, special tracking system with the light chain levels, if there are people with reduced kidney function, and that the iStop was able to provide some information about that. Can you expand on that?
Yeah, so again, going back to how the mass spectrometer works, it can be much more precise. And we do have sometimes difficulty following patients who have light chain myeloma. So remember that the protein that's made in myeloma is this big immunoglobulin or as we sometimes call it, antibody, that's composed of a heavy chain and a light chain. Sometimes the whole thing remains intact. Sometimes there's the heavy chains plus the light chains, and sometimes there's just the light chains. And we have a light chain measurement that we do in the blood, but that's sometimes skewed a bit by kidney function, because typically our kidneys clear those light chains out of our system. So if the kidneys are not working as well, those light chains hover in the blood for longer. So we're now just trying to understand, the best way to measure them, what the implications are of those measures. And only in, you know, big, big studies like in iStop can we capture all of that information.
You know, what can people look forward to, I guess, from iStop? I know we don't have a crystal ball, but what's a great new, you know, check-in point, or what are you hoping the study will answer, and how long will that take?
Well, it is going to take years to get all of the answers that we have, but I think we're going to learn in the shorter term what the true incidence of these conditions are, and could there be certain populations that we should begin to screen for, maybe, you know, in an earlier capacity. Excuse me. So that may be one of the questions that we see. And also, part of the iStop was not just collecting this information, but patients were randomized to different groups, to a more intense versus a less intense follow-up. And so this may influence the field even in the short term as to how frequently should we follow our MGUS patients, and when do we don't do bone marrows, and when do we do x-rays, and what are the psychological impacts of having MGUS? This is one of the things that, you know, I think is particularly important in the study as they do surveys with patients, is would patients rather know that they have MGUS, and does that induce more stress? And initially, it does not appear to induce that, that people are more comfortable understanding it than fearing they may have something that hasn't been diagnosed. So there are lots of things in the short term about the psychological impact of MGUS, how we follow MGUS, and whether or not we should be screening earlier in certain populations.
Perfect. So stay tuned. But, you know, obviously, this is such a great study. Thankful to all these Icelanders who've agreed to take part. I mean, that's going to be, I think, you know, share so much information that we don't have right now. I wanted to ask you, Dr. Mikhael, something about the follow-up 4.5 years after with the slightly higher mortality rate in patients that had that M protein detected versus not, and not just that it was a higher risk of myeloma, but also other blood cancers and possibly things like heart attacks. Is that right?
We're starting to understand a little bit more of that. We tend to think of MGUS as being a precursor to myeloma. And so the worry, if you will, about MGUS is that someone develops myeloma. And that, of course, is the central concern. But we're starting to notice something else, that patients who have MGUS may have other associated conditions and that their overall survival may be compromised. And we still don't fully understand this. And I don't want to raise too much of an alarm yet because we're still sorting it out. But there may be greater connections to certain kinds of heart or kidney or other disease. And we're trying to understand the mechanism of that. Is it really driven by the MGUS, or is the MGUS just telling us something else that's going on within the immune system or within the body? And this is the kind of thing that really can only be fully assessed and understood in something like the iStop study. And so that's one of the things that we hope to have more answers about in the not so distant future.
How often are MGUS screenings even happening right now in America? Where are we hoping to get to? Obviously, all this data is showing there's a lot more that can be done here.
Yeah. So right now, there's still no one, whether it's the International Myeloma Working Group or, you know, our organization, the National Myeloma Foundation, or any really institution, no one is yet recommending that we just screen largely. I think the approach is we're learning more about this and we'll understand it better for the future. I do know, however, that I think it's really important for us to say that when we identify people with signs and symptoms that could be consistent with myeloma, so there's a difference between screening sort of a general healthy population and saying, oh, if someone has certain features, and this is part of the work that I do, and a big part of my role at the International Myeloma Foundation in our Empower initiative, which is to educate the community and primary care docs about when to test for myeloma, how to recognize the signs and symptoms, and then, of course, what exact tests need to be done, which is the serum protein electrophoresis and the light chains like we talked about earlier. So when people have a low hemoglobin count or fatigue that is not otherwise explained, or a bone or back pain in particular that's out of keeping with what we would expect, or their kidney functions off, there's a whole series of things that kind of trigger this. And sometimes, in particular within the African-American community, this isn't thought of because these are many of the things that we may see, for example, with diabetes. And some may say, oh, that's just from your diabetes, and not look a little bit deeper. But for those people who are listening and already have established MGUS, I think what it reminds us is that it's important to continue to be followed. Thankfully, the majority of people with MGUS will not develop true myeloma. But now, as we have better techniques to measure it and better understanding of the disease, we want to keep an eye on it so that we can intervene when necessary.
What is the follow-up once someone is, you know, has MGUS, is officially in the system? What's that follow-up like, and how long should it go on?
Yeah, so the quick answer is it depends on someone's MGUS, and obviously they need to talk to their own physician about that. We have different groups that have provided different guidelines. In general, people with MGUS are seen either once or twice a year. So either every 6 months or every 12 months, depending on, we have a sort of a grading system within MGUS that are people are at higher risk and people that are lower risk. This is also what we want to learn from iStop, because they have a strategy there to look at how frequently should people be followed. The other question you asked, which I think is very good, is that right now it appears that people really do need to be followed indefinitely. It's not like maybe in some situations where if you go 5 years and there's no progression of MGUS to myeloma, you can stop looking. We see that people, unfortunately, can progress even after having MGUS for 19 years. In their 20th year, it can happen. So it really is, unfortunately, a lifelong follow-up for now.
Perfect. And then the last question here, just to wrap up with the screenings, is how I know it's going to take years, right? Essentially. And what I'm hearing is the screenings and all that, we don't have enough data. It will take some time for us to get anywhere close to that.
I think it will take some time because the implications are huge, right? Massive screening programs are obviously very consuming and have to be done correctly if they're going to be effective. And we don't want to screen a whole group of people where it may not be necessary. So the day may come where we'll say, at a certain age and based on someone's gender or ethnicity or race, that there may be a greater risk, and therefore it triggers the need to be screened. And that's kind of how we do it now, right? We don't screen everybody with mammography or with colonoscopies in their 20s and 30s. We set an age. If someone has family history, then their risk is increased. Someday we'll probably come to that. We're just not there yet.
Okay, great. Thank you, Dr. Mikhael. And for Dr. Mikhael's entire conversation, head to thepatientstory.com where you'll find human answers to your cancer questions.